Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai. Great pre-owned inventory as well. And fabulous deals to be had. And when you look at the deals that they have right now, oh boy, you can really save. There's no getting around it. And also, when you look at Sunbury Motors, a fabulous service department. Fabulous service department. And they just do a great job all the way through. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. All right, Nate Bauer and Ben Jones on the show today. To talk about the Patrick Chambers situation. Jim Ferry will now be the interim head basketball coach at Penn State after the literally stunning news yesterday that Patrick Chambers will not be the head basketball coach any longer at Penn State. And it was stunning, and here's a couple things I want to just get into briefly here to start the show. Obviously, I've known him since the day he took the job, and there's no getting around it. I think everyone knows. I think the world of Patrick. And I also think he did a really terrific job here at Penn State because I think it's one of the tougher jobs in the country. One of the tougher jobs in the country, without question. And he took one of the tougher jobs in the country, entered in, by the way, in a tough situation. Let's start with that. You know, suddenly, the job opens up in October. Excuse me, the job opens up in late May, early June. That's not a normal time to start your tenure as a basketball coach. You don't get a chance to get a late signing period or anything like that. Overall, I thought he did a terrific job with it. They won the NIT in 2018. They were an NCAA tournament team this past season, which, even though there weren't bids handed out, we all know they were. So that was important. Players graduated. Mike Watkins, prime example. And I'm around the program, not a little. I'm around the program a lot. But you can still be around the program a lot and not be around everything. You're not in one-on-one meetings. As many practices as I go to, I can't be at every practice. Especially as the season goes, for example. Season goes, they shorten up practices. I think you may have noticed I'm on this show until 5 o'clock. So there'd be many times along the way. There'd be times along the way where I'd get over to practice, they'd be done. So I wasn't around every second. So I have no insight. And I do not know what was found that they didn't know about with the internal investigation. That I don't know. I have no clue to that. Patrick is a passionate person. The number of players that will tell you they love the guy is obviously a long list. And I thought he did with everything in what is a tough job. I thought he did a really, really good job here and enjoyed all the time I personally spent with him. Jim Ferry steps in, and Jim Ferry is going to be the interim head basketball coach. Jim Ferry is an excellent choice because he's been a head coach at LIU, took them to the NCAA tournament a couple of times, and at Duquesne, where he made that program better, really set up personnel-wise what Keith Dambrot's been able to do there. But Jim set that up. Excellent offensive mind, great demeanor. Keith Urgo, still there. You know the high regard I hold Keith. Ross Condon, still there. Taylor Battle, you know what I think about Taylor. But the players have to overcome what is a tremendous shock. You don't sit there, this being now October 22nd, you don't sit there on October the 21st that you're going into a team meeting after you've started your preseason practices and you're a little bit more than a month away from your opening game. The last thing you expect is that your coach is going to stand in front of you and tell you that he is going to be no longer your coach. And Patrick, by the way, is the one that delivered the news yesterday to the players. He told them himself. The leadership of a John Hara, a Jamari Wheeler, a Miles Dredd, a Myron Jones, maybe even like an Isaiah Brockington or a Seth Lundy or a Trent Buttrick, is going to be absolutely critical at this time. Because let's face it, you have everybody around the program that is shocked by this. You don't expect it on October 21st, yet the oddity in all of this, for me personally, is that Jim will be the sixth basketball coach I've worked with. And this is, what, my 39th season coming up. Dick Carter was the first head basketball coach I worked with. And Dick was released at the end of the season. You know, within a day or two of the end of the season. And they brought in Bruce Parkhill. But then Bruce left in September, which shocked everybody. And Jerry Dunn took over. Then when Jerry was gone, then Jerry left within a couple of days after the season of his final season. And then I met the aforementioned Ed DeCellis late May, which meant Patrick was hired in early June. It was right past Memorial Day. That doesn't normally happen. And now this happening in October. So of the five previous coaches I've talked to dealt with, three left at times that were much later than a normal cycle. Unusual. The players are going to have to somehow overcome this. Now, the positive for them is they've got a month now to adjust to this idea. You have freshmen like Dalian Johnson, DJ Gordon, Caleb Dorsey, Abdu Zimbilla, and a transfer in Sam Sessoms that will never play for the head coach that brought them in. The big adjustment for them. This is where the upper class leadership, the leadership council that Penn State has, is going to be so important. They're going to have to somehow overcome their own shock and get the younger players through it. This is what the coaching staff is going to have to do. They have to overcome the shock and get the players through it. And it's probably going to have to be an us against them mentality as to how they're going to do it. But whatever it was in that internal report, Sandy Barber is not one that jumps 12 steps ahead and gets rid of coaches. That has not been her MO or her pattern in her career ever, and especially here, and I can attest to that. So whatever it was had to be compelling enough for her to say, you know what? We don't have any choice here. We have to make this move. Now, I don't know what's in the report. I don't know. As I said before, I can't say enough great things personally about Patrick. Can't. As a coach, person, friend, whatever. But I also know that whatever is in there, which we may never know, whatever that additional piece, we know it's not an NCAA violation, but whatever that additional piece of information was compelling enough for Sandy Barber and Dr. Barron to be concerned enough to make a move. And Patrick was decided to resign. So now, the next thing you do is you push forward. Players have to push forward. Staff has to push forward. Everybody associated with the program has to push forward. And if you're a player right now, this is the situation you have. In 2020, the most unusual of unusual years. You're sitting here today with a different head coach than the one you had on Tuesday. You're sitting here today not knowing what your schedule is for the upcoming season, because it hasn't been released yet. And you're sitting here today knowing that when you do play the schedule, there'll be no fans in the stands. Not easy being a student athlete. Nate Bauer on the show today. Ben Jones on the show today. Our high school roundtable today. Come back. We'll have some sound bites from Sandy Barber from yesterday in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Sunbury Motors. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC Way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC Way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC Way. The SMC Way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. All right, Penn State Vice President for Intercollegiate Athletics, Sandy Barber, spoke with the media yesterday. She started out by talking about Pat's success and how the players found out.
Coach Chambers has made many contributions to the program and to this university, for which we are grateful. But as difficult as this news may be, we think it's in the best interest of Penn State, our program, and our student-athletes. Our student-athletes found out about 4:30 today. Coach Chambers is the one that delivered the news to them. And as you can imagine, it was difficult news for them to hear. Coach Chambers has many current and former players that have been glowing in their praise of him. And, you know, our current players have very good relationships with him. And he is the one that has given them this opportunity. And so they are they're in a little bit of shock. And they're very disappointed. And although I am sure it will take them a little time, I am certain that they will find their footing and move confidently and successfully through the academic year, through the COVID-19 environment, and the competitive season.
Meanwhile, Ben Jones of StateCollege.com asked Sandy about the timeline.
Sandy, I don't want to get into the things you don't necessarily want to talk about, but was this investigation solely a product of that story? Were there things, enough things that came out after the fact that led you to believe that? And is this the sort of thing that it's all in the same area, or are there other things that came up that led to this decision?
Yeah, the allegation was previously unknown to Penn State and was independent, unrelated to the Undefeated article.
All right, so now the question is about the fine line in coaching today.
And that obviously is something that coaches in general nowadays, really do walk a fine line. And it's obviously my job as athletic director to evaluate that. And it's there's behavior that represents your values, and there's behavior that you don't. And I'm speaking very generally, and that's typically what I lean on from a values perspective.
So they will be in search of a new head basketball coach. Jim Ferry obviously is going to have a 28-game audition for it, and then we'll see what direction they want to go in for the future of Penn State basketball. And there'll be a lot of names thrown out there. There'll be people speculating. There'll be a lot of people that have absolutely no idea what they're talking about throwing names out there. I've discovered over the years that there's many people that are very good at that. You sit there and go, really? All right, okay. But everybody's entitled to their opinion about who they think the next head basketball coach should be. I'm going to sit back and wait and see what they're going to do. It's a shock to everybody across the board. Players, staff, sitting in my chair. Yeah, I mean, I was shocked to hear about it yesterday. But, and by the way, I've had a number of people, I get texts or emails, you okay, you okay? I'm perfectly fine. I mean, I've got to do shows and things like that. There's things I have to take care of. I've got a coach's show tonight I have to do with James, and that'll be this evening as well. And then I got to get up tomorrow morning. I got to fly to Indianapolis. So, I feel awful for the situation. Awful. But I also have to keep pushing forward with what I'm supposed to do. So I appreciate everybody that's texted or emailed. I appreciate that very much. I appreciate the fact people care very, very much. Now the question will be getting back to work and seeing how the players handle it in practice. Again, the stability of having Jim already there, having Keith there, having Taylor Battle there, having Ross Condon there, the philosophy is not going to change that dramatically. And you know what? You can then go out and do this us against the world thing, which is always something that it's always interesting to see how young people have the ability to bounce back incredibly well. And I'll give you a good example. I mean, young Luke is, he's going to have to overcome his father. The ability of that youngster to bounce back is going to be critical. What?
No, you're right.
I'm telling you, that kid's ability to bounce back, he is going to need it, man.
He's ready for another Eagles game tonight.
Look, if the Giants win, the Giants will be a half game in front of them.
That's correct.
This could be the single worst division in the history of the NFL.
Exactly right.
The rules state the winner of it gets a playoff berth.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai. Also, awesome pre-owned inventory. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. All right, high school football. We're going to change for a moment. Nate Bauer next half hour. Paul Domowicz will be on the show in the final half hour. So let's start with the Chief and Shikellamy. First of all, welcome back to the show. The guy we had on your place last week was still talking when the segment ended.
Well, that was my fault because I completely lost track of time last week. So I have to take credit for making you go through the pain of it. So I apologize.
I felt like I was on a rotisserie. All right, so let's... So for Shikellamy, Dave, obviously offensively has been a struggle. Why?
I go back to the fact that they just haven't had anybody that could consistently put five people together in the offensive line. Even up at Jersey Shore, they lost another starting tackle and they put a sophomore in. And he's, you know, probably last year as a ninth grader, he didn't get to play much, and all of a sudden now he's playing against one of the better teams. I think that's the real problem. I know that when we try to pass that ball screen, he doesn't have a lot of time back there before he's got to make a decision or he's got to get out of the pocket or try to avoid the rush. So
I think it's a matter of getting some people that know their assignments and then have a
physical ability to take care of a lot of – well, everybody rushes, runs stunts. You know, 3-5 defenses, and you got to just get used to picking them up. And one of the main reasons, I do know that we had a couple of big plays, and we can't put that back to back to back, so we can get a consistent drive, or we pick up two or three first downs, and then we stall. So
you mentioned
with inexperience.
You mentioned a ninth grader playing. How young is this team in reality?
Well, they have some a nice group of seniors, but there's a lot of underclassmen, 10th and 9th graders, freshmen and sophomores to go along with the juniors. So I'd say right now in the line that they're very, very inexperienced. The quarterback's a senior and one of the wide outs, but you know a lot of the running backs are juniors and sophomores. So I'd say that they're probably 60% underclassmen. From all 22 spots at play.
All right, so now that would bring to the next part. All right, do you see any building blocks for the future with these young players that maybe they're setting a foundation for future Shikellamy seasons?
Well, I'll tell you, the defense last week held a very good team from Jersey Shore to 7 points with 3 minutes to go in the game. And it was the outstanding play of those five kids that were playing the linebacker positions. They are basically underclassmen, and that's a good start there. I'm thinking that I think Coach Kaiser said, you know, the kids finally are getting what they need in order to play the type of defense we have, and they did it last week against a very good team. I think they shocked the world when it was only 7-0 going into the game. They're building. I thought we went a long way last week to becoming the football team that I think everybody is expecting or wants at Shikellamy. Just got to get some consistency in the line. And even though those kids are young, they're getting a lot of experience this year. So they know what it takes to play, and I'm sure they'll work hard for next season. Plus, we've got 3 games to play yet, so there's lots of time to get better as you play. Learn as you go.
One of those wins is over Milton, so what do they need to do this time around to make it 2 in a row over them?
I think they basically just can't, and I don't think they'll do this. I don't think they can just let it slide by and say we already beat this team. Milton's got some capabilities to go deep, and they've got some kids that can make the long one. So I think if they play with the same consistency that they did at Jersey Shore and don't let down this week, that they'll really have a good game against the Black Panthers.
And again,
I know they did it offensively. They got that first touchdown before the end of the first half against Milton last time they played, and that just turned the turned the whole ball game around, and I think that's something they've got to do again. They've got to score first.
Dave, always a pleasure. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it.
You're welcome, Steve. And, hey, have a good time in Indiana, all right? We'll be listening to you.
Thanks. I appreciate that. I'll double our ratings. Thanks. All right, let's get to Zach Showers. Sealers Grove, they're winning. Zach, great to have you with us.
Hey, it's good to be back, and it is nice to talk about a win for a second week in a row.
Yeah. Okay, so what are the common threads between the two wins here, Zach, that's really made a difference?
Well, they were both low-scoring games. Honestly, the biggest thing is defense is continuing to be dominant. They're making plays. They're getting a lot of tackles for a loss, putting Salins Grove in good field position. And for the second week in a row, you might look at the score and say 9-7. There wasn't a lot of offense. But to be honest, both teams kind of held onto the ball and ran the ball a lot. So it was a very quick game. And Salins Grove's offensive line has played just a little bit better every week the past 2 weeks. They had no negative rushes this past week, which was a huge improvement over the beginning of the season. So overall, it's just a lot of just being a little bit more consistent, and the line is moving the defense a little bit, and that's opening up some running lanes.
The defense has been the constant all season long. So let's take it one more step. How's this defense been at takeaways?
They've been up and down with takeaways. They've been more of a team that's getting a lot of tackles for losses and sacks, and then getting good field position off of that. I think they have, I want to say, 5 or 6 interceptions and another about 3 fumble recoveries. So they've been fairly opportunistic with turnovers. But a lot of it's just been getting in the backfield. I think they had another, 12 or 13 tackles for a loss this past week, and 5 sacks. So it's been pretty dominant defensively in that aspect.
All right. So what are the keys, the important factors in this week's game? Try and make it 3 in a row.
Yeah, well, this week's going to be interesting because
yeah.
it's pretty. Salins Grove and Shamokin are going to play next week again, So you're looking at back-to-back games. And in all reality, the only thing that matters this week, the only thing that can change from this week, is home field advantage. So if Salins Grove wins, it'll be at Salins Grove next week. If Shamokin wins, it'll be at Shamokin next week. You know, both teams, I think Salins Grove has gotten a little bit better. The first matchup, they lost 16-0. They only gave up 1 touchdown drive, and the other 9 points came off of a blocked punt that was returned for the touchdown and another blocked punt that was a safety. Right. So I expect Salins Grove defense to be able to handle Shamokin again. And if the offense can continue to do a little bit of what they've done the past 2 weeks, I expect Salins Grove to be in this game and definitely have a chance to win. A few weeks ago, Central Mountain, who Salins Grove beat last week, was able to put over 40 points on Shamokin's defense, and they did that with a ginormous running game. They ended up running the ball for 378 yards, and their running back accounted for 246 yards of that. So there are some plays to be made against Shamokin. It's a matter of if the Salins Grove line is able to block that 8-man front, and if they're able to block that 8-man front and can get past that first line of defense, there's a lot of big plays for the running game. I think Brandon Heil and T. Hoover, the 2 running backs, have been close to breaking some the past 2 weeks and just haven't been. And I think there's some potential there if you can just get that 1 extra block, that some of those 10 or 12-yard runs can turn into those 40 or 50-yard runs that a lot of other teams have had against Shamokin. So that's the big thing. Shamokin offensively comes out in their wing tee offense, and honestly, they don't do all that much different than what we saw against them in week 3. So Salins Grove had a little trouble with the misdirection game the first time they played. And if they can handle that, I think they'll put the Salins Grove offense in some good positions to come away with a victory tomorrow night.
Zach, appreciate it very much.
Absolutely. Have a good one.
That'll be on Eagle 107 tomorrow night. 100.9 The Valley. Lewisburg will play. All right. So, Greg Wetzel, on a day like today, you had to play golf, right? You had to.
Oh, I definitely played golf today.
Yeah. Played well?
My team wanted to trade me today. I'm a free agent tomorrow.
Yeah, I'll take you. I'll take you. All right. When I look at Lewisburg's schedule so far this season, is the only reason they're playing these teams is because the Packers weren't available?
Well, they called the Packers and they turned them down. They didn't know if they could compete with Lewisburg.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I've seen a high school team have to negotiate this kind of schedule.
No, it is. It's unbelievable, and you know, and it's hard to see growth in the team because of the way they're losing. But last week they might have played their best game of the year against Southern Columbia, but lost 42-7. The defense only gave up 28 touchdowns. Shemokin ran an interception back for a touchdown and then recovered a Lewisburg fumble in the end zone that was over the quarterback's head, a snap. So the defense only gave up 28 points. And, Steve, if you remember, last week we talked about angles of pursuit.
Yep.
The Green Dragons were in excellent pursuit angles. They just couldn't make the tackles. They were, you know, the Garcia boy and Barnes kid, Wes Barnes. They broke all kinds of tackles in the backfield where they tried to hit them high instead of hitting them low and turned them into big gains. Otherwise, but they were in perfect position. They just didn't make the plays. And now
how difficult is it to convince a team that they played their best game and they know what the result was? How difficult is that?
Boy, that's where coaches earn their money.
Yeah.
You know, that is a tough thing. But, you know, the kids and Lewisburg was out without two stars on offense and two stars in defense last week, which will be back this week against Loyal Sock. But the kids are in a good frame of mind. I mean, I was at practice Tuesday and a little Wednesday, and they're in a good frame of mind. They're excited about the upcoming games. They think they have a chance to compete against Loyal Sock and Hughesville. So they're in a good frame of mind, and they're feeling good about themselves right now.
All right, so that's where they are. So now when they play this week, what opens the door for them to, you know, snap out of this? And there's nothing like the validation that you're getting better than in winning. So how do they validate it this week?
Yeah. Well, number one, Steve, the first drive of the second half, Lewisburg has turned the ball over in every game they played this year on the first or second play.
Oh.
That's something they have to get over. They've been outscored 42-0 in the first minute of the second half of combined games. So that they have to change. And the other thing they have to get, you know, we're into the seventh game of the season coming up now. They've had a bad quarterback, center quarterback exchange every game. That's something that has to stop because they get a drive going. All of a sudden, instead of second and 8 or second and 7, it's second and 22 or 25 because the snap goes over the quarterback's head. And this is an offense that just can't have those setbacks. You know, they just can't overcome them. So those are a couple things they have to cut down on, those mistakes. And the other thing, the offensive line play has to become a little more consistent. Defensively, they become a little better. Offensively, they have to become more consistent and stay with their blocks a little longer on offense.
Greg, over the years, I've always felt that teams that are in the underdog role and struggling, mm-hmm. where they feel like they have to play that perfect game, and they're going along and they're playing it, they're getting a little more confidence, and then one thing goes wrong,
and all the
confidence gets flushed.
It's tough to play that way. It's tough to play that way. You're exactly right. And again, when you talk a lot about getting the lead and playing with the lead, last week, first play of the game, Southern Columbia runs a sweep to the left. Hitting the backfield, the Southern Columbia kids hitting the backfield, fumbles the ball. Lewisburg picks it up, runs into the end zone for a touchdown. Except the refs said the player was down.
Right.
Wasn't down. I don't think it would have made a difference in the outcome of the game. I think Southern Columbia still would have won. They're a much better team. But, boy, would have it gotten those kids excited to play with the lead against a team like Southern Columbia.
Yep.
And that's what they need to do against Loyal Sock and Huesel. They need to get the lead, the defense go in, get a stop, and the offense get back to the field and ready to take a two-score lead. That's what they need to do.
Greg, always a pleasure, my friend. Thank you so much. Appreciate you being here and appreciate your period.
No problem, man. Have a great time on Saturday.
I appreciate that. Thanks so much.
I'll be tailgating in my driveway and watching the game.
I love it. That's great. Enjoy it. All right.
We will. Take care.
Thanks a lot. All right. We will come back with more in a moment. So, again, Shikellamy will play on News Radio 1070 WKOK, their rematch with Milton. We have Selins Grove and Shamokin, first of two, because they'll play again next week. And that'll be on Eagle 107. And Lewisburg, of course, will be on 100.9 The Valley. Back with more in a moment. Nate Bauer, next half hour. Here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Great to have you with us on the show today. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Our thanks to our great reporters for joining us today, Dave Ritchie, Zach Showers, Greg Wetzel. High school football. What is this, week number? Is this seven?
Yep, week seven.
Wow. Week one for Penn State's this week. So I just thought I'd pass that along.
You know, in case you live under a rock or something.
Yeah. It's week eight of the college football season, week one for Penn State football. At least it's here. At least going to give it a shot here. You could just hear in James' voice. It's just, you feel like with this whole thing, he talks about respecting the virus and so forth. You feel like you're walking on eggshells. You know? And that's what you feel like. You feel like you're walking on eggshells with this thing all the time. But suddenly out of nowhere, you don't know. Dan Mullen comes back home. Suddenly Dan Mullen's got it. Okay. I mentioned yesterday about if a player tests positive on the daily test but negative on the PCR test, okay, then they can play in the game because it's considered to be a false positive. But part of that also depends on what day it happens. What day is it? In other words, you know, suddenly you test positive the morning of the game. Well, you're not going to get the result back from your PCR test. But if it happens, say, on, like, today, a Thursday, okay, yeah, all right. I mean, that's how touchy this is. And just nobody knows. Nobody knows. That's why I said to Jack the other day, we're, you know, talking, I said, well, now it's up to, quote, go time. I said, now we got to see if they can survive to get to go time. And so far, they've been okay. Okay. So far, they've been okay. James will be on the show tonight beginning at 6:30. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, key routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com.